As you can see, ladies and gentlemen, I have arrayed our panel to some degree regionally, so I'd like to start out in the Middle East and then work our way across, and I'll begin here with you, Minister Al-Mazrui. Your strategy for 2050 foresees an investment of approximately 15 billion euros, if I did the math right, into renewable energy and into transition of the energy system in your country. So what are cornerstones of that strategy? And in particular, how do you plan to leverage what is a very significant amount of capital?
Actually, it's 150 billion.
Okay. And that sounds even more impressive.
The strategy was a bottom-up strategy. So this is not, we decided that we will not push the companies to come up with a number if it doesn't make sense commercially. So we started with four pillars, and I'll try to be brief. One is the reliability of each source and the security of supply. Second was the affordability. Third was the sustainability, which includes the environmental, of course. And fourth was achieving happiness to the inhabitant of the United Arab Emirates. And working with all of the stakeholders, we came up with the energy mix of around 50 fossil and 50 green or zero emissions, which was really a shock for us at the beginning. Because we thought that if you go green, you need to subsidize. But it's the opposite. Actually, the team came up with this formula of 50-50, which will save us around more than $192 billion if compared to do nothing, which is going gas all the way. And that has been the strategy. And so our leadership, they are bullish about moving to achieve that strategy. We put milestones and on a yearly basis, and every 5 years we're going to review the strategy. But we think it's achievable, and we think it will save the environment, and at the same time save us lots of money.
Thank you very much. Would you say a word about efficiency, please? Because it was mentioned a number of times yesterday as an absolutely crucial aspect of getting us where we need to go. It's been a big issue for Middle Eastern countries, a lot of low-hanging fruit on that efficiency side. So could you say a few words about how that figures into your strategy?
Sure. First of all, we need to admit that we are not efficient today in the Middle East. We are far from being efficient. If we look at the generation, we have so many open-cycle power plants that doesn't make sense to continue with them with very low efficiency. The reason they are there, because gas is subsidized, and gas is not the business of the power companies. The government provide the gas and they pay for it. Well, that is not going to continue in the United Arab Emirates. We are looking at it differently. When we look at any new project, we will look at it on the basis of LNG not subsidized. The tariff as well, we need to move. If we want to improve the efficiency, then we need to remove the subsidy from the tariff. And if we do that, those two, I think we can, there are lots of low-hanging fruits that we can capture, and we are starting with a big campaign in the United Arab Emirates trying to convince the people to change and move toward the higher efficiency in the generation, efficiency in the transmission, and also demand side management. There are lots of hanging fruits there.
Thank you very much. Let me move on now to Egypt. And Dr. Radi, Egypt is considered a potential investment hotspot for renewables. So my question to you would be what you are doing to try to attract international capital into that sector, and perhaps with one added point, reading up on this issue, I noticed that there is some question from some investors about the degree of policy coherence, whether Egypt really is all in on this or not. So perhaps you could speak to that point as well.
Thank you very much. Egypt is a heavyweight in the Middle East, let's say. And the problem which in energy, like all the other sectors in Egypt now, that we are in transition. Egypt is in transition for the last 5 years, and transition is a big, big hurdle, but at the same time, is a big potential and opportunity. Why is this the hurdle? Because we have to grow. We have to have economic growth, and the economic growth part of it is the industry, and the industry needs energy. And the industry actually in the last 5-6 years was growing more than what we have from energy. Until last year only, we started to pick up an energy which would be enough for industry and household. This is a big opportunity because a big part of this should be from renewable. According to our energy mix, which was previewed for 2022, we have to have 20%. Like Europe, we copied it. A big potential in solar and wind is there. And the system is, we are putting it rightly. I wouldn't oppose what you said, that we have some policy hurdle there. But first, due to the transition and what entails, you are really racing with yourself. In the last 2 years, we have blackouts till 2015. So sometimes you don't have the luxury to think of policies for long term. You wanted to, our president talked to one of the big operators in Germany, and he told them, I can have the station in 2 years. He said, no, I want it yesterday. because he made it in 1 year, because we needed capacities and power immediately. And that was, let's say, we are breathing now out of this hurdle, and we start to look longer for, in a longer term, for policies. What are we doing? We change it, let's say, in the policies, I'll say just, not to take a lot of time, some signals. The first signal is maybe Egypt is the only country or the first country in the world which has in its constitution renewable is mentioned. Because our constitution was rewritten 2 years ago, and our people were so conscious to put renewable as a cornerstone in energy within the constitution. So we are obliged by constitution to go in renewable as fast as possible, as strong as possible. That's number one. Number two, our Ministry of Electricity has, its name has been changed last year to electricity and renewable energy, to have it also very well in the conscious of everybody in the name itself. We changed the law to allow, for the first time, Egypt was a monopoly for government in electricity generation and transmission and so on. Now private operators can work. Of course, it's theoretical in the, but we have a lot. We were talking with our partners. Germany is one of the biggest partners, and for their experience, both in the regulatory and in the implementation, is a model, which we really are trying to learn from it. And in this case, we are trying to put the best policy possible. We started, as everybody, with the feed-in tariff. It went not as we wanted, but we have 3 signatures 2 weeks ago. We went another round in feed-in tariff, and now, like everybody, we thought, like the Arab Emirates, we learned it from them too, that it's better to go in competition. Competition would be better, would be a fair game for operators to go. The potential, the attraction is there because the potential is strong, the need is there, the growth is infinite until 2 decades to come, And the policies, we work together as partners because we need it, and we need the success for our operators to come.
Just one sentence, if you would, please, on one particular issue, because we do have potential investors here in the room. Something that has concerned some international investors is arbitration.
Yes, you're right.
Could you just say one sentence about that, and perhaps you can later.
That has been solved, because there was our prerequisite was where to have the arbitration. And actually, it's a theoretical question, because it's a psychological question. Because if you have arbitration by definition, you get a judge from your side, a judge from my side, and one in between. If it is in Europe, if it's in Egypt, if it's in the US, it doesn't matter. But some of the investors wanted to have been located somewhere outside of Egypt, and we are solving this. That is coming to a solution.
Okay, thank you very much. Let us now move on to Norway and the fourth of your cornerstones, Minister Mazrui, was happiness, if I remember. And Norway won the World Happiness Prize yesterday. So I know that Ms. Tronstad must be very happy. And certainly in the energy area, Norway has many reasons to be happy. It's blessed with abundant hydro resources. It's also a leading oil and gas producer. So one might wonder, how interested is Norway in other renewables?
Well, one of the speakers yesterday said that we are present here today, or yesterday and today, you know, because we want to make a change. And I think Norway also see that it's that there needs to be a change from the carbon use of carbon in the energy sector to other renewables. But in Norway, I mean, 98% of the energy consumed is actually renewable and from hydropower. And we share the hydropower we have with the rest of Europe as much as we can. With Germany, with Britain, with Denmark, so we are trying to sort of not only use this ourselves, but also share with the rest of the world. And of course, I mean, we have from Norway, we also have lots of gas. And what we see is that we are now producing more gas than we're producing oil, and this is also something that we want to share with the rest of Europe. And of course, I mean, it is more. How should I put it, renewable, it's cleaner to produce using energy using gas than using coal, for instance. So, I mean, that is also one way that Norway can actually contribute to a cleaner, using the resources we have and contributing to a cleaner world or Europe for that sake. So I mean, we see the changes. We have signed the Paris Protocol, of course. So we want to contribute in the way that we can and use our resources in a most renewable friendly way. And of course, I mean solar. We have a big solar energy industry. We have wind. I mean, we're strong in wind, both offshore wind and also onshore wind. And that is something that we are developing is also in Norway, but of course this is a technology that we can use and that we can sell and that we can share with the rest of the world.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to come back in a second round of questions to international cooperation. I'll be interested also to hear from you about Norway's perspective as an investor, because of course your fund is also investing in other countries. So let's take that in a second round.
Yeah, I'll be happy to answer that.
Thank you. I'll move on now to Germany, both to Thomas Silberhorn, both within the framework of cooperation, but also with a perspective for Germany itself. The Agenda 2030, in which, as I said, you were closely involved in those negotiations, as well as the Paris Agreement, do open up new opportunities, the minister reminded us. How do you see those opportunities for both public and private actors?
Well, let me start with the clear commitment of the G7 to decarbonize our economies until 2100. This means that for investments in fossil fuels, the costs will increase, the risks will increase, the life cycle will decrease. That's why it's hardly time nor money to be successful with investments in fossil fuels. So we have to transform our approach, and I like very much your idea to bring happiness to your people. Because if you really want to organize change, you have to overcome obstacles, you have to convince people. Of course, electricity brings power and light, but in the end, welfare, yeah, happiness. So as politicians, we need a clear vision where to go and what to do to achieve these goals. With renewable energies, we significantly stepped up our commitments bilaterally and multilaterally. So for example, over the last past 2 years, we spent more than 2 billion euros in renewable energy and energy efficiency only from our ministry's budget. And we integrate our expertise in our bilateral development cooperation with many, many partners, 35 bilateral development partners. Of course, our approach is not only to talk about access to energy, to talk about mini-grid approaches to achieve many people in rural areas, to reach them there, but also to talk about legislation, regulation, technical standards, trading systems, feed-in tariffs. All this is crucial to create the right framework to be attractive for investors. But beyond this, and of course, to add, we contribute to the renewable energy initiatives in the framework of the European Union, in multilateral development banks, in particular, the African renewable energy managed by the African Development Bank. We contribute only to this initiative 3 billion euros over the next years from 2015 already to 2020 in order to install an additional 10 gigawatt renewable energy capacity in Africa. But beyond this, I think we have to discuss the more structural questions, how to attract more private finance. If I'm informed correctly, today already 85% of all the investments in renewable energy are done by the private sector. So this shows very clearly what we all know, that there is much more private capital in the world than taxpayers' money. So we have to create the right framework conditions to be more attractive. And we have to get the clear vision that it's a public interest to channel private investment in the direction of sustainable development. If this is not done, if private investment is concentrated on fossil fuels, then this could completely undermine our approaches of the Agenda 2030 and the Paris Climate Agreement. So we have to reflect how we could improve the framework conditions in many, many countries, and this includes the financial markets as a whole. We have to state that there is a lack of trust in many countries in weak institutions, and it's worth to reconsider how we could bridge this lack of trust by making a better use of our development instruments, of our financial instruments, guarantees, for example, including the multilateral development banks. And to be more concrete, we'll have a side event with, together with the International Finance Corporation, the private sector arm of the World Bank, at the spring meeting of the World Bank Group in April now in Washington. And we will exactly address this question, how to better frame the conditions for private, not only investments, but for private finance in our partner countries. And this, for example, could lead to better instruments and better usage of local capital. If we succeeded in using local resources for infrastructure investment, then we could diminish the broad risk of devaluation of many currencies. And this is one significant factor in infrastructure investment. If the money comes from outside only and is confronted with devaluation of local currencies, it's a threat to many public budgets. So we have to get a bit broader approach, and this includes not only our activities in bilateral and multilateral cooperation, but also the setting of the framework in our partner countries. And to end, if I'm allowed to just make this notion, we established together with our environmental ministry and together with Morocco, the NDC partnership last year at the COP22 in Morocco, a partnership including industrialized countries and emerging economies and developing countries, international multilateral organizations, in order to support our partner countries in implementing their nationally determined contributions, in order to support them to link their climate targets with their development agendas. And this, of course, is open to participation for anybody who wants to be climate champion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I want to come back to that point in just a moment. But let us first go to the US, and in particular to California, which has seen an extraordinary increase in renewable investments and in energy efficiency. And I was quite interested to see in Angus McCrone's presentation the remarks about tax credits and the role that they played. So if you would tell us, Tom Steyer, perhaps a word about the success factors in California, but also a word about where we may be going in the context of federal policy in the US and how that could impact what has been an extraordinary success story.
So let me say that I come here this morning as an American, of course, but also as a Californian and a Democrat. So, so you can expect a very specific point of view from our very messy country. Let me say this. California claims to be the fifth largest economy in the world. Over the last 2 years, California has passed laws that said we'll be 50% renewables by 2030, that we will double our building efficiency by 2030, and that by 2030 we'll have reduced our greenhouse gas emissions by 40% from 1990 levels. This year, we're talking about renewing our cap and trade, and in addition, there's talk of going to 100% renewables by 2045 in the state. So when we think about what's going on, in the United States of America, if you're not from there, let me just say electricity is regulated at the state level. So when we think about what needs to happen, we think about clean up electricity generation, electrify everything, get a lot more energy efficiency. So from a California standpoint, when we look at clean up electricity generation, we're well on our way. And the other thing that you should know is that across the United States, regardless of political party, the people of the United States want to move to clean energy. So that means even in the places where their elected officials are pushing very hard to stay with fossil fuels, the people of the United States, if you poll them, regardless of whether they're Republicans and regardless of where they're from, want to move to clean energy. In California, we overwhelmingly want to move to clean energy. We're overwhelmingly Democratic. And as a result, not only are we cleaning up the electricity generation, we are over half of the EVs in the United States. We're number one in solar. All of the things that you'd want to do from a business standpoint happened disproportionately in California because of policy. And we can see that happen, but we can also see, you should know, that across the United States, including in Republican states, and since the presidential election in November, there's progress being made towards clean energy in states with Republican governors like Illinois, like Michigan, Indiana. So the U.S. will move regardless of what happens in Washington, D.C. And let me explain that. Let me give you a concrete example of something that's going on. Under the Obama administration, they passed a regulation that we would move to 54 miles per gallon average for the fleet by 2025. That was something that was passed without any vote of Congress, but through the administration's executive action. That is something which we're well on the way to doing and is eminently doable, but the Trump administration is now reopening that, is going to spend a year examining whether that is feasible, whether it's economic, whether it's good for jobs. So if you hear that, that is very chilling from an American point of view, and I'm sure it's not very reassuring if you live outside the United States too. But one thing you should know about the American system is this: California gets a waiver to set its own miles per gallon rules. And California is about 15% of the vehicle purchases in the United States of America. So very few companies, as in zero companies, want to produce two different kinds of cars in the United States of America. So to a very large extent, what happens in California has translated to the other 49 states. So as we go forward, I do not want to sugarcoat this for you. If you look at the Trump administration and who he has nominated and put into his cabinet, they are people who are, without exception, radicals, not acceptors of climate, and defenders of the fossil fuel establishment and fossil fuel companies. Against that are arrayed the facts, the fact that we have a very dispersed system, and the legal system of the United States, which remains intact. So as we go forward, what I would advise you to expect is a fight. And the President of the United States and the Congress of the United States, which is Republican, have a great deal of power, but they don't have unlimited power, and by far the biggest pushback will come directly from the people of the United States, organized both at a local grassroots level and through the internet. And as you watch this unfold, watch that, because elected officials in the United States will be watching it very, very closely. And if the people of the United States speak in a coherent and coordinated fashion, it will be very hard for anybody to stand up against them. And that will be the test of exactly where we're going as a country. Thank you.
The very briefest of follow-up questions. The very briefest of follow-ups, if you would, because this is a panel on investments, and you made a very considerable investment through the Political Action Committee of your organization to try to put up candidates in the election who would, let's say, not be voices for the oil and gas lobby and for very powerful vested interests in the U.S. who, of course, are pouring billions into election campaigns. That effort was not, I think, as fully successful as you had hoped. Will you do it again in 4 years?
So let me describe what actually happened in 2016 from our standpoint. We spent about 50%, I'll say, maybe more, in California. And in California on November 8, which was our election day, we had an unbelievably successful day. You know, we have super majorities in both houses of our legislature for Democrats. We passed very large numbers of propositions and measures for public transportation, low-income housing, and reform of the labor market. And in general, we got just about as good an outcome in California as we could have hoped. We spent half our time outside California, working on both Senate races. We have 180 partners outside of California, our organization. We knocked on 11 million doors. We're on 370 college campuses talking to students. And outside California, I would have to say, you know, it couldn't have been more disappointing. So the question was, would we do it again? So I would have to say, if you look at the consequences of failure, that of course we would do it again, and we plan to do it again. Because from our standpoint, the idea that we wouldn't solve this problem and that you would save money in the because you didn't think it was worth it would be completely illogical. So from my standpoint, what we think is at stake in the United States and in the rest of the world is something of a magnitude that people are very uncomfortable even talking about. So if you ask me, would I like to save some money and take a, you know, and not give our very best effort in what we think of as the generational challenge for the entire globe, I don't think I'm that cheap.
Thank you very much. And a very, very important reminder that the transition is not just about policy frameworks, it is also about political economy. And there is a powerful political economy at work all around the globe. So let me come now to Christian Parker and ask you, in terms of the investments that your foundation makes, it does invest directly in projects. What kind of policy framework are you looking for? What is that enabling framework that you would say make the investment, that's the fruitful background for your investments?
So I'm not a politician, but I'm going to do what they do and not quite answer the question. Tom's organization reminds me of, Next Gen, the fact that I heard about a practice that the Inuit have, which is that they, when they need to make a big decision, they have several of the elders represent multiple future generations. So if I'm thinking about the best way to describe what I see the role of our foundation, which is a family foundation, is to do that, to represent future generations. And I think, we also spoke about polling. I think it's pretty clear that if we polled future generations, the kind of polls we would get back with respect to how things are going, it wouldn't be a positive poll on our success rate, despite things changing faster than we ever imagined on renewable energy. It's not happening fast enough. So when I think about our investments and to get closer to your question, effectively as a foundation, we work through partners. We work through civil society. And it's civil society organizations like the European Climate Foundation and others that help create the enabling environment that give you the policy framework that we're looking for. I'd also like to say, though, that when you look at how much the philanthropic community is investing in climate change, it's pretty teeny. It's 1 to 2%. And I think everybody in the room knows the scale of this problem, and that's not anywhere near what it needs to be. At dinner last night, I spoke about the idea that it gets to what Tom was saying, that if you're a foundation 50 years from now and you're sitting on an endowment and we haven't solved climate change, what's the point? So I would suggest that foundations need to spend at a minimum 5%.
What's holding them back?
I mean, I think, the discussions today, this is a very complex issue. It's a very political issue. It's an issue that sometimes for philanthropists it's hard to decide where to start. But I hope I'd like to see that change, because I think, like we've heard about through the last day, things are moving much faster than we ever imagined, despite not being fast enough. So I think momentum is on our side. Change is inevitable. It's just a question of the time frame. Are we going to do it fast enough? We have to, as a community, make some hard decisions. We have to, I think in Europe, one of the things that needs to happen is that we need to find a way to accelerate exit from coal. If we're going to create the space for renewable energy to reach the levels it needs to reach, then we need to give it that space. And it doesn't mean that we don't also have to focus on a just transition for those who are affected by that change. But I think, ultimately, we have to do that. We've said it, and it's inevitable, but I think it has to happen a lot faster than I think people have talked about, so.
Thank you very much. And let me now just make a link between what we just heard about next generation and coming back to the Middle East again. You have an enormous youth bulge, a huge next generation coming up. And from what I heard from both of you, there is some degree of tension between the aim of generating enough economic growth to provide employment for them, and at the same time, the impulse to deliver a sustainable future. So how do you see that tension, and how do you resolve it, basically? And I'm going to have to ask for very short answers on that point, because we do want to try to get some Twitter questions, and I want to also come back briefly too on the issue of international cooperation. But perhaps you would say just very brief word on that.
I think the renewable energy going all the way to improve or optimize the efficiencies is a huge industry. So there will be lots of job creations just going that route. And that's how we see it. We have seen companies that are now specializing in converting buildings to a more efficient. We have seen products, we have seen industries. At the same time, when you go to the solar and solar what works in the United Arab Emirates at least, you see lots of companies as well, from the product to the maintenance to all the way. And that would create a huge jobs. When the electricity becomes, when we generate efficiently, then there is lots of saving, and that saving makes more industrial projects viable, which are not viable at the current system. So I see the opportunity on the saving huge, actually.
Thank you. Dr. Vadi?
Thank you. I think it's the opposite, what you're talking about, because let's say 3-4 years ago, that was the notion. But with the more knowledge about the potential of what the transition is entailing, young people are on board. However, policies which we are talking about are the key, because renewable and the growth in the, let's say sustainable growth, could create more jobs than what we thought. We have to get out of our mind the notion that sustainability is again is creating new jobs. No, we will create new jobs in new areas where innovation is needed, where young people are the engine for that. And I think that's what we should work on with our partners, because in Egypt and the Middle East, not only Egypt, growth would be, exponential, because we are still. I was talking to our partners in Germany yesterday. I told them, you have the luxury when your transition to clean energy is from capacities which you have. You are really substituting. We don't have this luxury. What we are building is new capacities for new generation, which has actually had to have more investment and more jobs to create.
Thank you very much. And then just very brief word from you, Ms. Rønstad, as an investor. When Norway is investing, it's a very considerable fund. What are you looking in terms of policy frameworks in other countries?
I think stability is, the main word here, and transparency. And you asked, you mentioned, this Norwegian fund, the government pension fund global, which is probably one of the reasons why we are so happy and in Norway. This is a global pension fund that stems from revenues associated with the extraction of oil and gas, and on the Norwegian shelf, of course. And this fund, it serves as a tool to support long-time considerations on the spending of such revenues. And the fund is, from the Norwegian side, is also a very long-term savings vehicle. What is important is that it's neither an environmental nor a foreign policy instrument, as we see it. And even if it's sort of a governmental fund, it's actually managed by the Ministry of Finance, but the operational management is done by the Norwegian the central bank, and we don't invest in Norway. And if you want to look into this, you can look at the web pages, because I think it's one of the most transparent funds in the world, actually. And looking at environmental related business, we see that during 2016 it was roughly 7% of the equity benchmark that consisted of companies with more than 20% of their earnings originating from environmental related activities. And this is a fund that today is about 130 billion euros, so it's quite a lot of money. So 7% does not maybe sound so much, but I mean, out of 830 billion euros, it's some money. But also this is a big investment, but as a smaller investment for my private sector and for my private life, and I'm not a politician, we see that stability, political stability, transparency, reliability is extremely important, because of course you want to have you want to be sure that your investments are safe.
State Secretary Silberhorn, also with the request for a very brief answer, if you would please. Your ministry has called for a Marshall Plan for Africa, and you mentioned earlier the efforts in development cooperation to work on issues like capacity building, like policy enabling frameworks. Can you say a word in particular about that cooperation with Africa? What is going to be key there?
Well, the idea is that we need similar efforts today as we had it in Europe and Germany decades before. This Marshall Plan has a very positive connotation in Germany and in Europe as a recovery plan, yes, but also as a plan that initiated ownership in Germany and in Europe. And that's what is needed in many African countries. To our impression, businesses have been oriented towards Asia for six decades now, very successfully. They contributed to the development, economic development of many Asian countries. We see more and more middle-income societies there, but they ignored the African neighbor continent nearly completely. To give you an example, we have in Germany 400,000 companies that are invested internationally, but only 1,000 on the African continent. So this is nearly nothing. We appreciate each and everyone who is engaged in Africa, but we need much, much more. And now it's time to develop these African markets and to contribute with private investments to this. And this requires more awareness of what's going on in Africa. This requires the will to understand what's going on there, and there are huge potentials. We, in the last decades, not only in Germany and Europe, we tended to talk about Africa focusing on crisis and conflicts. And this is much too simple. We have to identify the potential for development, economic and political development, and this is the right time now. So what we are proposing with our Marshall Plan with Africa from our ministry, also in preparation for the G20 presidency in July, but also for our bilateral development cooperation, is on the one side, we want to strengthen those governments that are reform oriented, and secondly, we want to discuss about a fair global order, including taxation or international trade. So it's a two-track approach, more a structural, systematic approach when it comes to the questions of taxation and fair trade, and a more concrete or bilateral approach to support reform-oriented governments. And one of the outcomes, or possible outcomes, of our G20 summit in July might be, or will be, to offer investment partnerships between G20 countries and African partner countries. And we want to very concretely improve the conditions for German and European investors in Africa, offering, for example, new guarantee instruments, negotiating also non-double taxation treaties and investment protection treaties, so everything which is needed to create a better framework for investments in Africa, incentivizing German and European industrialized countries investors. But at the same time, as I mentioned before, we have to talk about framework conditions on the ground in our partner countries. This is in our mutual interest.
Thank you very much. Let me ask Mr. Twitter to come and join us, because I've seen a number of interesting questions and remarks flowing across the screen here, so perhaps you'd share that with us.
Yes, actually, there is quite a number. I'm trying to make a selection here. The first question would go to Mr. Steyer. Could Germany's managed hard coal phase out be a model for socially better coal mining regions in the US?
So one of the big political questions in the United States has to do with a just transition from coal. So let me give you a sense of how big an issue that is in the United States. So we have about 320 million people, and at the end of 2016, there were 53,000 coal miners in the United States. By contrast, there were 550,000 people working in clean energy in my home state of California. So from a monetary standpoint, in terms of taking care of coal people, it is a trivial exercise to make sure, and it's also a morally important exercise to make sure those people are taken care of. And they tend to be in very rural parts of the United States where this is really a wage issue. Coal miners in West Virginia, where I was about a month ago, make probably at least double what the average worker does in those regions. Those are not places that are hotbeds of new industry. There are not a lot of competitive jobs if you lose your job as a coal miner. So even in states like Ohio, which has 12 million people, 2,500 coal miners, considers itself a coal state. So when we think about this politically, it's absolutely incumbent on people who want to move to clean energy to deal with this problem, which is to make sure that the workers here are taken care of. And it is a rounding error from the standpoint, from an economic standpoint, but a critical point politically to make sure that in a country which is going through very rapid transition, that the equity is shared with people who are more distressed and who are going to pay the price of moving from fossil fuel and specifically coal energy into a cleaner future that we have to do.
Okay. The next question goes to Dr. Hamid Al-Masri to the United Arab Emirates. And the question here is on the competitiveness of the renewable program versus the nuclear program. So how competitive is the renewable program compared to that?
Well, within the strategy, by 2050, nuclear is going to be only around 6% of the total energy mix. So nuclear is not going to be, we're not going to rely on nuclear in a greater extent, but nuclear was needed when the gas prices went to $14-$15. Nuclear always as a base load saves you as a hedging. With the issues associated with the nuclear, I think the other greener forms of energy like renewable would be a greater choice. That's why we are going 44% renewable compared to 6% nuclear. And nuclear is green too, because it does not emission CO2. So the combination of the two is going to be 50%. But I think I see more chances of renewable energy overcoming nuclear in the United Arab Emirates.
But nuclear being a part of that, obviously. Okay. There's one question concerning our market that we aren't exactly covering on the panel here, but the question goes to all panelists. Esteemed panelists, what is your take on emerging Indian renewable energy market in context to its 175 gigawatt renewable energy target by 2022?
May I ask Angus McCrone to address that, because we can't possibly ask all panelists, unfortunately. We're very tight on time. So maybe, Angus, you can say a word about that.
So I think there's very good news on India and also somewhat worrying news in that I think they're very serious about the renewable target and the solar target, and they're beginning to wind up that program, investing about $10 billion a year now in clean energy, and that's going to increase, I think, quite rapidly towards the end of this decade. So that's all good news, and they're achieving very low prices for solar generation in particular, some of the new projects coming through. The worry with India is that they will have rapidly increasing electricity demand over the next 20 years, and coal is very competitive in India. It's mined locally. Some of the regulations there are probably not as tight as they would be in more industrialized countries. Coal is very competitive, so we could well end up in a situation where both renewables and coal grow quite sharply in India over the next 20 years, and that would be worrying from the emissions point of view. So I think that, in a way, India carries a very important role for the future of global emissions. The choices it makes between how much renewables, how much coal, will be very, very important to what happens to overall CO2 in the world.
Thanks very much.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's one more question that I'd like to highlight that has also a larger political reference, and that would be going to both Mr. Al-Mazr and Mr. Radi. Will the phasing out of fossil fuels finally bring a peace dividend to the Middle East?
In 30 seconds or less.
Exactly.
I don't think we should be talking about phasing out. I think it's a healthy competition between the different forms of energy, where subsidy needs to be taken out of the equation. The problem is when you subsidize the fossil fuel and then you ask the renewable to come and compete, that is not fair. And I think we are moving away from that. And that's, I think, the way we should go.
The heart of the question, though, of course, is about oil and conflict.
I don't think we should worry about that. There are requirements in the world. The demand increase, if you look at any statistic, for all forms of energy is rising. Oil is a finite resource, so it's not going to be there forever. We need to have a transition, and I think we are in the transition. We need to promote that transition, but this is not a substitution. I think naturally we will get there, but we need not to introduce subsidy or penalties to address one versus the other.
Maybe I could make it a bit easier on you by asking you to comment on not only that, but climate insecurity and conflict. Climate insecurity also a factor.
Some people like to look at the fossil resources in our region as a gift and a curse at the same time, because if you look at the conflicts in the last two decades, a lot of them were much related to energy-rich countries. I will not name countries, but it could be. What we are looking at in the fossil, that will bring me to a small thing which we in Egypt we are trying to do in the Eastern Mediterranean area. We are trying to forge a cooperation to create an energy hub there. It would be for gas, resources, and also renewable in the future, and to link to Europe through Cyprus and Greece. And some form of this cooperation could be a base for, you know, the Eastern Mediterranean area is also not one of the most stable there. Some form of energy cooperation there could be a stone in creating peace. I agree with the thing, with the general notion which have been in the tweet.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
That answers the question from our questioners out there.
Thanks very much, Paul Christian. So, ladies and gentlemen, to close this very, very interesting exchange, we have a final word from the Minister for Energy, Utilities and Climate of Denmark, Lars Christian Lilleholt, and he will close out our session, and then we will give everybody a very warm round of applause. Please, sir, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the invitation to be here today. And thank you for the interesting discussion during the workshop. It's a great honor to be able to present the Danish perspective at the Berlin Energy Transition Dialogue. Last month, the World Bank published a big report on green energy. It concluded that Denmark has the best framework conditions in the world when it comes to green energy. A few months earlier, the World Energy Council published its annual report. It also found Denmark to be number one in the world in providing stable, cheap, and green energy. These results made everyone in the Danish energy sector very proud. Denmark has now shown the way to green growth. Since 1990, Denmark GDP has concluded while the use of energy has remained constant and CO2 emissions have fallen. I think there are four main reasons for this development. First, since the 1970s, Danish energy policy has been based on broad political agreement between most parties in Parliament. This means policy stability, and that it is key to investors who think long-term. The government's goal is to make Denmark independent of fossil fuel by 2050 and to cover at least half of the total energy needs with green energy by 2030. This will help create stable and long-term policies. Second, financial supports for specific technologies have advanced technology development and cut the cost of energy. In the future, however, we must look to more market-based solutions. This way, we can spend our money in the most effective way. Third, good conditions for research have been important. Companies have been able to test new technologies, for example, new wind turbines. The government is right now looking at expanding national test sites for both onshore and offshore wind turbines. At the end of last year, we had a tender for the new Danish offshore wind farm of 600 megawatt called Kriegers Flak. This tender was won by Vattenfall for a price of only 5 euro cents per kilowatt hour. A new world record that confirms Denmark's position as a leader in wind energy. Our long-term goals is to make Denmark the first country in the world that can deploy new offshore wind capacity on market terms alone without any financial support. Moreover, Denmark is a part of Mission Innovation, and we are committed to double public investment in clean energy research and development over 5 years. Fourth, the Nordic countries has a well-functioning and integrated electricity market. This means that the wholesale price of electricity in Denmark is the same as in at least our neighbor country 90% of the time. When the wind blows in Denmark, we sell power to Norway, Sweden and Germany. Hydropower plants in Norway can fill their dams, and when the wind doesn't blow in Denmark, Norway can re-export hydropower to Denmark. This helps integrate wind energy into the market. The government works for European electricity market that is integrated, market-based and flexible. Energy should flow freely within member states as well as across national borders. Alternative energy must be integrated into the system. And Europeans had to be sure to have power when they turn on the lights. National frameworks cannot stand alone. All EU members states should look at their energy policies from an European perspective. And we must work together to create a good European framework for the green investments. These were some of the framework conditions that have helped Denmark make a leader in green energy. My ambition is to maintain this position. Therefore, we must work together on an European and global level. Discussion, what works, and learning from one another is an important step in this direction. I would very much like to thank you for the invitation to speak here today, and I wish you a good conference.
Thank you very much, Minister. And interestingly enough, Denmark, too, was very high up on the happiness index. So perhaps we see a correlation between renewable energy and public happiness. Might be worth exploring in next year's transition dialogue. Many, many thanks to our panelists for this truly very, very interesting exchange.